Okay, I think it's time to start. Let me welcome all of you to the Center for European Studies. It's our great pleasure to have this event taking place here. My name is Grzegorz Ekiert. I'm the director of the center and professor of government here at Harvard. Now, 5 years ago, if someone would tell you that there will be a vicious war going on in the Middle East, in which hundreds of thousands of people will be killed and millions of people will be displaced, you would not believe in this. If 5 years ago someone would tell you that the one European country will invade another European country, that the thousands of people are going to be killed and tens of thousands of people being displaced, you would not believe that. If 5 years ago someone would tell you that the biggest humanitarian crisis in the world is going to be in Europe, you wouldn't believe that. And if someone would tell you 5 years ago that the richest part of the world is not ready and able to accommodate a million of refugees escaping from the war, and the countries of the European Union, which for 30 years were living on the generosity of others, receiving billions and billions of dollars, would say, not a single refugee, you would not believe it. That is why we need organizations like the International Committee of the Red Cross, and that is why we need the visionary leaders like Mr. Peter Maurer. Mr. Maurer comes to Harvard to receive the inaugural Elizabeth Wines Humanitarian Award. And it is my great pleasure and honor to welcome you to the Center for European Studies. We will have the opportunity to hear your views on the migration crisis in the Mediterranean. Mr. Maurer holds doctorate in history and international relations and had a distinguished career in the Swiss Foreign Service. Among many other important positions, he was appointed ambassador and permanent representative of Switzerland to the United Nations in 2004. And in 2010, he was appointed the Secretary of State for Foreign Affairs and led the Swiss Department of Foreign Affairs. In 2012, he became the president of International Committee of the Red Cross. And under his leadership, the committee carries out humanitarian work in over 80 countries, and the budget of the committee increased by almost a third. Now, before I invite our distinguished speaker to the podium, I would like to thank the staff of the Center for European Studies for working very hard on this event. But first of all, I would like to thank the Harvard Humanitarian Initiative for bringing Mr. Maurer to Harvard University. And I would like to invite the Initiative Executive Director, Negeen Darani, to welcome the speaker and the audience. I would like to say that this event is being recorded and filmed, so it will be for everyone to see for many years to come.
So hello, I'm Negeen Darani, the executive director of the Harvard Humanitarian Initiative. First, I'd like to thank everyone on behalf of HHI. I'll just take a few moments to tell you a little bit more about HHI and the Elizabeth B. Wines Humanitarian Award, for which Dr. Maurer is the inaugural recipient. It was actually through the incredible generosity and commitment of the Weintz family, Polly, Eric, Rosemary, Fred, and Beppe, who are joining us here today, that as one of our core donors, that it really became possible to establish HHI, and through the vision of our co-founders, Dr. Michael Van Rooyen and Dr. Jennifer Leaning. And today we are an interdisciplinary research center here at Harvard with a deep and broad network of faculty, students, fellows, and affiliates who are really bringing data-driven and evidence-based approaches to improving humanitarian response and to really informing and better understanding community resilience for populations affected by crisis. We also have an educational arm, the Humanitarian Academy at Harvard, which is a model for encompassing a community of learners, both here at Harvard, undergraduates and graduate students, but also practicing humanitarian professionals around the world. And through really developing and communicating a core set of competencies for basically developing the humanitarian leaders of the future. The Weins family, in their most recent demonstration of their tremendous commitment to our work, have established the Elizabeth B. Weins Humanitarian Award, really to honor visionary humanitarian leaders such as Dr. Maurer, and also in remembrance of the philanthropic spirit and vision of a very dear family member, Elizabeth Betsy Weins. And so we're really honored to be celebrating today the inspiration of these two individuals. And one last note of thanks to the Center for European Studies, to Dr. Ekiert and Elaine and Rumi and your team for allowing us to collaborate with you and be part of your esteemed directors series.
Thank you. So please join me to welcome Mr. Maurer to this.
Dear Weins family, colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen, it's great to be back to Harvard. As I just had the opportunity to say, it's not my first time here on the place, but since 1998, when for the first time I got associated with HPCR, Humanitarian Policy and Conflict Research, where Claude, who is now at the president's staff of ICRC, was working at the time. I have come back to the place because I appreciate a lot the academic, methodological beef up of operational activities in which we are engaged. And I have been engaged in diplomacy of a country and now in an organization which deals with law, policy, and operations on humanitarian level. And it's a great opportunity also to see a very good old friend, Jennifer, back here at Harvard. We go back to the last century. So I really appreciate the opportunity to say a few things on migration here. I look even more forward to the discussion afterwards. But let me just start with Grzegorz. Believe it or not, introduction that you made beforehand. Indeed, one of the signs, just to illustrate how on top of the reality he was in his introduction, is that today ICRC has the largest operation in the Middle East, where conflict seemed unthinkable a couple of years ago. It's one third of everything we do in the world. We do in Syria, Iraq, Lebanon, Jordan, and Yemen. So five countries make up to 35% of all budget activities of ICRC. Just I wouldn't have thought 6 years ago that this would be the reality. Secondly, it strikes me that while we thought when I started in 2012, I thought, and I had the sort of ambition at ICRC to thin out as much as I could any operations still left in Europe, because this was basically the place where you had to cut if you had to cut. And so we basically, my ambition was starting, I said, well, let's bring everybody down from Europe and send it to the Middle East, where conflict started, and to Africa, where we had conflict dynamics. And we have our sixth largest operation worldwide now on the European continent in Ukraine, where ICRC is amongst the only, if not the only, international organization still with an access to the Donbas and a huge program in the Donbas. We wouldn't have thought. And 4 weeks ago, I was in Greece visiting to see what ICRC, which is not a migration agency, and works close in conflict, and less with the larger consequences of conflict, was discussing with the Greek prime minister on opening an office in Athens, the first office in the European Union, which would have an operational dimension. So indeed, just to illustrate that, believe it or not, we are where we are at the present moment. It's good to be at Harvard and to talk about migration, because a multicultural crossroads of people like this one is a good reminder of what science has brought to migration policy for quite some time, and we know it, that the positive impact on migration on societies, on academic research, on age structure in society, on innovation, on economic development of a society. We all know that there are downsides of migration as well. We know about the dangers, the exploitations, the traffickers, the intercultural difficulties, the integration problems. We have done research on all those issues, but by and large, science says, and is quite in agreement as much as I perceive, that migration is positive for societies. And what is troubling is that body politics articulate their views in a very different way. Body politics in Europe tell to European politicians that migration is not what the European societies want. And this is deeply troubling and has troubled me now for decades. That while all the economic, scientific, societal indicators on balance come to positive results, the political articulation once a society is confronted with migration is rarely a positive one. There are positive examples as well, but to discuss maybe a little bit later what makes the experience positive and what makes it less positive. Let me also, in the light of what happens in Europe, maybe just remind us of one or two figures. It's always good to keep dimensions when we talk about migration. The so-called mass migration or migration crisis in Europe looks very strange to a president of the ICRC. We are working in the most stark and difficult conflicts of the world. In 50 armed conflicts, we have our core operations, and our main customers and beneficiaries are displaced people by violence. And most of those displaced today in the world are internally displaced people who live still in the place where the conflict takes place. Out of 60 to 70 million displaced by violence today, 45 million are internally displaced, and they live in the country where the conflict is taking place. I always say only 4 million Syrians are abroad. 8 million Syrians are displaced internally. Most of the humanitarian problems that we are facing with internally displaced people who flee conflict and violence, but they flee in the neighborhood. And why do they do that? Because they keep hope up that as soon as the conflict is over, they want to restart their lives as close as possible to where they come from. People do not migrate for no reason. Most of the people want to stay where they are. And so most of the problems are where people stay. And the big humanitarian response on which we are challenged today is how do we scale operations in the numbers of conflicts with all those internally displaced persons who have no legal status as refugees. So out of 60 million, 45 million are internally displaced, 15 million are refugees, 10 million are stateless people in the world. And these figures can be contested, but by and large, it's the ones everybody is used to use. If we look at the 15 million refugees, those who left the country have crossed the border. Most of them live in neighboring countries of where the conflicts take place. Those countries who are recipients of refugees are neighboring countries of conflicts. First, Iran, suffering from the conflict in Afghanistan and Pakistan. So they get the largest number. You have Ethiopia in Africa, the largest country with the largest refugee population on the African continent. It's squeezed in between Sudan and Somalia. So they get the refugees from both of the country. Those who are in despair of being displaced internally and they flee to the neighboring countries. It's the Lake Chad region, which has a lot of refugees because of the violence of the Boko Haram. It's the Horn of Africa. It's Afghanistan and Pakistan, and it's always the neighboring countries which are those who are most exposed to people displaced by violence. So I think it is important in the whole discussion that we keep proportions. It's not only a subjective feeling of people like us who think that it is only marginal what comes to Europe. It's also, objectively, if we look at the proportions, not the big numbers ending up in Europe. Maybe another point I wanted to make in this introduction is that we have an enormous confusion of terms and terminologies in this discussion. We always discuss migration. And migration and migrant and refugee and displaced by violence and legal and illegal and voluntary and involuntary and all those terms are used somehow indiscriminately and in a not a very sharp way with regard to what we are talking about. So nobody really knows what the migration crisis is. There are 250 million people living outside their homes, their nation, national homes today. But most of them are living happily where they are, and they are contributing to the economies and societies in the countries where they live. So there is not really a migration crisis with which we are confronted at the present moment. We have a crisis of people who suffer because they are displaced by violence in their country, in their own country, in the neighboring country, and along migration route. Let me maybe make another point here in the introduction. There is a lot said in the European discussions today that migration levels haven't been seen and the dimensions of the migration level haven't been seen in decades, and that this is putting an enormous pressure putting European societies under enormous pressure. But here again, let us not forget the numbers of people who moved in Europe during the Hungarian uprising of 1956 and the Czechoslovak uprising of 1968 were much bigger than today's migration crisis. Three times more in the case of Hungary, twice more in the case of Czechoslovakia. So, and this has been decades ago. And Europe, in the meantime, has been exposed to all sorts of population movement, migration movement, refugee movements, and has become a different society. So something is strange with the terms and terminologies and assessments that we are finding continuously in the so-called migration debate and the number debate. These are not big numbers. It's not that technically it would be impossible to integrate 1 million people on the European continent. Let's face it. There are 30 million tourists going to Greece every year. And these tourists find houses. Of course, they pay for houses. But I mean, when somebody wants to tell me that it is physically impossible to find shelter for people who need shelter in a country of the European Union, I have a slight problems with the dimension. What strikes me in the political debate in the European Union is the amount of panic and rhetoric of panic which has come to political leaders. I would expect political leaders to follow the basis. That's what political leaders do. But I'm surprised to see the amount of panic rhetoric which has come to the European debate. Don't come to Europe. I mean, when you look at the quotes, do not believe the smugglers, do not risk your lives and your money. It is all for nothing. Greece or any other European country will no longer be a transit country. They can't host you. These are words from responsible political leaders in Europe. And it's disconcerting to see that a population movement leads to a panic reaction. We know about the reasons. Of course, there are security problems with the migration movement. Of course, this is not to take lightly. Of course, there are problems to accommodate, to integrate, and to bridge the gap between those people who need protection and the integration capacities of the economies and societies in Europe. But this is a gap which needs to be managed, needs to be attended, and it's not the first time that a continent is confronted with this kind of problems. Let me emphasize once again, from where we look at from ICRC side at the European so-called migration crisis, there are good reasons for people to move. I just come back from Afghanistan and from Syria, where I have spent the last 2 weeks, 3 weeks, one in Afghanistan and one in Syria. And you put any European citizen or European politician to Homs or to Mazar al-Sharif and Jalalabad, and it's obvious that people flee for a reason. It's not because they think that this is an El Dorado. It's not because they have a nice life where they are. Cities in Syria are destroyed and unlivable to a large extent. And they don't find their homes, and they don't find any homes near the cities, and they don't find any homes more in the neighboring countries. And so population movement happen for a reason. Conflicts are still ongoing, and the reception structure and the ability of humanitarian actors to stabilize lives and livelihoods of Syrians and Afghans is limited. Of course, the Afghanis are in a better position today because their country is less destroyed and less affected than the Syrians are. But even there, it's not the poorest either of the Afghans and the Syrians leaving. The poorest stay where they are or go to the neighboring countries. But it's those who have been very often politically active, who have exposed themselves, who move further on, come to Europe, and put some pressure on the European system to receive those migrants. In the light of what has happened, and given where we are as a frontline responder to humanitarian crises and violence and conflict, we have carefully looked in what a strategy is to respond to those population movement. And the first and foremost response for an organization like ICRC is to try to scale our operations in the countries of origin. It is to scale up our operations in Syria, in Afghanistan, and to try to stabilize people where they are. This is the whole importance of humanitarian work and to make a life and livelihoods possible for people in Syria. Here again, it's not impossible. If international humanitarian law would be respected, at least in any satisfactory level, in a conflict like Syria, we would be able to help and to stabilize much more of the Syrians in Syria itself. If they wouldn't need to flee, if there would be a reasonable amount of respect for neutral and impartial humanitarian actors. So we continue to believe that one of the most efficient and effective responses to the migration movement and the movement of population by violence is to stabilize societies and to help people where they are at the present moment to respond to basic needs and social services. The second thing we have done is, together with the Red Cross and Red Crescent organizations in the neighboring countries, is to scale the operations in the neighboring countries. This is doable, it's easier, but here again, the reception capacities of neighboring countries, contrary to other parts of the world, is coming to a difficult point. Social services in Lebanon, in Jordan, are difficult to entertain. So scaling the operation in neighboring country, that's what we have done over the last 2 years. No other operation has grown so much as our operations in Jordan and in Lebanon. So it's important to scale those operations. And thirdly, what we are trying to do is to build networks of responses and humanitarian responses along migration routes in order to mitigate some of the negative effects of those who are displaced, giving them food, shelter, water, medicine, respond to their basic needs, and ensure that at least those basic needs are addressed on the migration routes. So let me just summarize up to that point. I think we see that the drivers of displacement by force are important at the present moment. We have never seen since the Second World War the amount of crises and conflicts and displacements that we see today. But those ending up in Europe are only a small fragment of those who are really displaced. For those small fragments, there are possible solutions, even if we have to recognize that there is a difficult that there is a difficulty in managing the expectations to be protected and the integration capacities of European societies. And there are strategies to cope in the countries, in the neighboring countries, along the migration routes with some of those stark problems with which we are confronted today. If we look at more practical solutions, what are more practical solutions? I must say, I have been impressed that whether in Syria or Afghanistan, when you ask people who are displaced what they want, they have a very clear ambition. And it's a program which is summarized in 3 points. They always tell you the same. It's jobs for us, education for kids, and security for communities. And I think as long as you can and as long as we can, this is the best program in order to cope and to mitigate some of the negative impacts of the crisis which is unfolding. I think we need a new compact, in order to deal with such a program, in order to address not issues either in Europe, in the neighboring countries, or in countries of origin, but to look at the migration issues in much a more comprehensive way. One of the issues that we are confronted today is clearly that political decision-making is taking place in organizations which are limited and not in sync with the migration routes. So you never have a comprehensive approach to migration routes where one response is following the other response. You have the humanitarians dealing with Syria. You have others dealing with the neighboring countries, and you have the Europeans sitting together and wondering what they should do with 1 million refugees. This is simply not politics which are in sync with the problem, but the structures are somehow not tuned to finding solutions to a complex flow of people moving in different directions. I think we need a change of mindset. Figures may be one thing, but also the continuous focus of what is not working is a problem. There is a lot of things which are working, a lot of job creation programs which are positive, a lot of educational programs for refugees which are working and can be scaled. So I think it is important here again that we inject a new type of confidence into solving some of the problems coming out of population movement. And we just do not stand there in just analyzing the problems and declaring that a solution is not possible. I think it is important to go back to some reasonable understanding of shared duty to address this problem. I think Gregor has mentioned it in its introduction. It is unacceptable that certain countries just declare that they are not part of the solution, because not being part of the solution is part of being part of the problem. And I think we are within Europe and globally in a situation where there is no reasonable political discussion on duty sharing and accommodating and investing in bringing some solution. I think we need some innovative approaches. I think engaging with the private sector has shown in Germany that some of those innovative approaches are possible. If you engage with the private sector, they are ready to create jobs for special occasions and to contribute to solutions. I think, again, educational programs have proven interesting. I think legislative programs which somehow try to time and sequence the moment when migrants, refugees come to the labor market in an intelligent way are good approaches to look at legislation and try to mitigate the competition effect, which again has political negative repercussions. So my point here is only solutions are available. They are even pilot projected. They are even working, but they are not scaled at the present moment because there is a lack of political will to scale them, to discuss them, to invest into the problem part of the migration movement. As a humanitarian organization, of course, I'm always asked, what is the humanitarian angle you are taking to the decisions that you have seen coming out of the European Union at the present moment? And of course, we are worried to see one of the staunchest supporters of international humanitarian law suddenly going into agreements which at least put questions on whether international humanitarian law at large, refugee law in terms of non-refoulement, in terms of opening options for refugees, third country solutions, that this organization is somehow opening doubts on their willingness to take international obligations seriously. We have been cautious for good reasons to go to accusations that we see violations of international humanitarian law in the EU-Turkey deal. A lot depends on how you make this deal happen. And it's encouraging that at least in terms of political declaration, many European Union leaders have said this is a deal which needs to be implemented according to the law. But of course, this needs implementation legislation, practice, procedures which are according to the law. A lot will depend on how European Union border police forces, NATO ships in the Aegean, how they will confront the migration flow which comes. We are interested to know about the standard operation procedures put in place and whether those who are picked up in the sea are picked up and how they are treated and what their options are and what the procedures under which they are and what the legislative framework is which opens some options to them. Of course, we are, as a humanitarian organization, concerned when we see more and more migrants going into detention, into migrant detention. It has always been our approach that migrants, because of being migrants, shouldn't be detained, that to the utmost alternative procedures have to be found. So we are concerned to see that increasingly in European countries, migrants disappear in detention. And here again, we are, as humanitarians, in front of a difficult dilemma. Should we contribute, visit those detention facilities in order to contribute to make more humane treatment and to ensure more humane treatment in migration facilities, or should we not? As humanitarians, we tend to be pragmatic. If people are detained, we are not asking whether they are detained for good reason. We are trying to ensure that we mitigate the problem of those being detained and we ensure and we improve conditions of detention. But it's a delicate balance and a delicate dilemma in which humanitarians find themselves today. We are concerned about the use of force in border policing and public security when talking about migration issues. Are all the police forces and the military forces which are now drawn upon in order to ensure public safety and public security, are they trained to cope with the specific issues of migrants protesting? It's a very bad picture when I see, as a European, when I see at the border of Macedonia and Greece, European border police and riot police tear gassing migrants. Not what you would expect to happen in such a situation. So my point here, just to conclude, is that while as ICRC and humanitarian organization, we are concerned on the respect of international humanitarian law and refugee law in the implementation of some of the deals which have been decided upon over the last couple of weeks. At the same time, we are pragmatic in trying to find and to encourage solutions and to support pragmatic solutions. But we can't just discard that refugee law is the law and it has to be implemented as good as ever we can wherever we are confronted with the dilemma. So being it in detention, in procedures of reception, in procedures of asylum on the European continent, in the implementation of non-refoulement, in the use of force with regard to the migration movement. These are important concerns that we have as humanitarian organization, and under which, with on which we intend to engage and we want to engage with the European countries. Once again, I mentioned proportions at the beginning of my few introductory remarks. Our activities on the European continent will remain marginal because we think that our core activity is where most problems are with displacement by force and violence, and those problems are not on the European continent. What is a problem is the example character of the European Union, which forces us to deal with the issues and entices us to engage with European countries and with the European Union, so that international humanitarian law and refugee law and procedures are respected on the continent as scrupulously as the European Union would like it them to be respected in other parts of the world. If there is one problem with prejudices at the present moment, is that procedures that are flouted on the European continent will be flouted in even bigger proportion elsewhere. And this would give us even an additional work in other parts of the world where the core of our activities is. I'll stop it here.
Thank you very much for those introductory remarks. Very important issues, critical issues, not only from political point of view, but also from moral and ethical point of view. In this discussion, I'm joined by two of my great colleagues. Melani Cammett is a professor of government at Harvard, and her research focuses on the governance and provision of social services in public, by public and private actors in the Middle East. Jennifer Lanning is professor of practice of health and human rights at Harvard Chan School of Public Health. She's a director of AXB Center for Health and Human Rights, and of course co-founder of the Harvard Humanitarian Initiative. Jennifer has been working tirelessly helping refugees in many countries. She personally took part in providing medical care and public services on the ground to refugees almost in every single big crisis we had over the last 20 years. So we have a lot of things to discuss, a lot of experience around this table. Maybe we'll start with some questions, comments from my colleagues, and then I will open the floor for a broad general discussion. Melani, would you like to say?
Thank you. Well, I'm delighted to be here. It's a real honor and to hear these important words, and congratulations on receiving the inaugural award. This is, I think, very well deserved. And also gratitude for all the important work that you and the ICRC are doing. I really appreciate the efforts to put the crisis in perspective and to point out that as a proportion of total population in the European Union, the migrant crisis coming largely out of Syria and other places as well is really minimal. And so the political reaction is really what's at root here. So, it's refreshing to hear calling a spade and homing in on the political dimensions here that shape responses to the crisis. And it makes it all the more embarrassing that this has become a political issue in the United States, where the flow of refugees is truly infinitesimal. So we can put it in perspective there as well. So I wanted to, raise a few issues or questions. I'd love to hear Dr. Maurer's thoughts on these issues and more. First, I think it's also refreshing to hear about solutions that have been tried, at least in the pilot stage, and work, because we hear a narrative of crisis, and disaster, which is true. Both things can be true, but also that there are things that work. So there are some sort of glimmers of hope here. And again, depressing to hear that there are political obstacles to scale them, but perhaps over time these political obstacles will evolve. And I have some questions about that as well. So I'd be curious to hear more about these kinds of programs and how they differ in different locations. So, for example, there are things that are being proposed, I gather, in European countries, say in Germany or other countries that have received large numbers or relatively large numbers of refugees. But also, of course, the largest flows of refugees are in the neighboring countries of Syria in particular. And I'd be curious to hear what is being done there, what can be done there. Recently, there was a paper by a scholar at the Carnegie Middle East Center advocating a focus on what he referred to as smart policies to address refugee crises, ones that focus not just on short-term relief, but also longer-term issues, because we know this conflict in Syria and other conflicts are not going to be resolved anytime soon. They're very protracted. They're very complicated. We've got lots of domestic actors on the ground complicating the resolution, but also a lot of regional and international actors. So it makes it quite a complex scenario to reach a true agreement. And even when an agreement is reached, I'm sure will be under threat for quite some time. So what kinds of policies can be done to address the well-being of populations that are displaced and in neighboring countries in a sort of medium to longer term framework? Because there are quite a few restrictions on employment, labor market restrictions. We know that in Lebanon, for example, I think something like half of Syrian refugee children are not able to receive education. Maybe that number's not quite right, but it's a large proportion, and other surrounding countries as well. So what kind of things can be done given the very real political constraints that operate in these countries, enshrined in law in terms of restrictions on employment and so forth? Are there creative ways to sort of foster more productive labor markets around refugee communities and so forth? And that gives rise to another set of questions of interest to me as a political scientist, which is each of the, I know best Middle Eastern countries and how they're adapting to these crises. And each of the major receiving countries around Syria has a very different institutional context. And this very much shapes the way responding to refugee outflows takes place and manifests itself. So, for example, in Lebanon, for various historical reasons, the government decided not to allow the construction of camps and not to deal with the crisis in that way. Whereas in Jordan, there have been camps created and so forth. So how does that shape the international humanitarian response? How does that facilitate things or complicate things? In Lebanon, you have in the welfare regime multiple non-state actors, private actors delivering basic services in times of non-crisis, in normal times. So it's a very different context than in, say, Jordan or Turkey, for example, where you have different levels of state capacity and so forth. So I imagine that the humanitarian response from the international side filters through this distinct international context. A couple more things that came to mind. We know that the effects of war continue long after the war ends. And again, I don't think that this war in Syria is going to end anytime soon. I hope I'm wrong, but it's not looking good. And the effects go on in terms of health effects, in terms of educational systems, in terms of labor markets, infrastructure, and so forth. And a number of international organizations have come out with reports documenting the lost generation in Syria of children that are out of school. And this is really disastrous because there's all kinds of second-order, third-order effects that play out. in terms of, you know, future prospects for economic development, getting Syria back to anywhere near the level it was at before the crisis in terms of human development outcomes. It also might be, from a very cynical perspective, these kinds of things might be of interest to European policymakers, because there is a fair amount of research that shows that one of the major drivers of recruitment in extremist organizations is exclusion, socioeconomic exclusion. And so, not to make a purely reductionist interpretation of the rise of extremist organizations, but it's clear that economic factors are critical for some important proportion of recruits to these organizations, and poor educational and job market prospects are key here. So perhaps cynically, this is a, you know, a body of research that needs to get projected more loudly into European capitals and into Brussels and elsewhere. And that actually brings me to a final question, which is, does this crisis winding up on European shores and in European territories open up opportunities for addressing the root causes of these refugee outflows? Now that people are fleeing the disastrous situation in their home countries and winding up as far as Europe, does this actually provide some incentive for politicians to come together and try to address them? So does, on the one hand, we have these political responses that are not productive at all, that you've outlined very clearly and we're seeing reported in the news repeatedly, but does it also potentially open up a window of opportunity? This is certainly the way that voices from the Middle East have looked at this very cynically, saying, oh, well, now that they're winding up in Europe and they're not just in camps in Jordan or in informal gatherings and communities in Lebanon and in Turkey and so forth, maybe there will be more of an effort to resolve these crises at their root causes. So thank you very much for your remarks.
Thank you, Melani. Jennifer, please.
Well, thank you for the opportunity to be here. And
could you speak to the mic?
I beg your pardon. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here. And warmest thanks and greetings to the Whitens family. And I hope you now realize that this first choice for the inaugural honoree was enlightened and splendid choice. Peter Maurer is a extraordinarily esteemed and respected leader, diplomat, philosopher, and public voice in the war and humanitarian space. And so it's a great honor to be in some way attached to your presentation today. And Melanie, I loved your questions. Answering them will take up a good share of whatever time we might have, but they're very, very, very important questions. my thanks to the Center for European Studies for hosting this, because it is, although it's a small crowd, it's an intense crowd. And could I just say that for the Wines family, who are not familiar with how things radiate out of this amphitheater, this is sort of a hot spot. You know, the things that happen here go far and wide. So it's a good place, Negeen. Thank you for working with the center to organize this. Thank you. I wrote down a number of things that I might say independently, and then I decided I would take Melanie's lead, which is actually allows me to say many things, but pose them towards you as questions. So the first off question is, what decided you to become much more outspoken on the European refugee crisis than I, as a student and admirer of the ICRC, would ever have anticipated? I mean, the International Committee of the Red Cross, solely and only among the humanitarian agencies, gains access and maintains its probity and independence by rarely speaking out in public about the violations of international law, international humanitarian law, that it witnesses. It's closest to the action. It sees many more violations than any other humanitarian agency or any other actor. And yet its history has been to be quiet in order to report to governments and the military about the violations in order through the respect of silence and confidentiality to not embarrass but in fact persuade the major bad actors to change their practice. And in also order to gain access to those who are most caught up in war, which often are displaced peoples or prisoners held by the more malignant or hostile force, if one can parse most wars that way. A very important time when I was aware that the ICRC spoke out very, very intensely with a high tone of urgency and marked, not even implicit criticism of the international community, was in the early years of the growing famine in Somalia in the early 1990s. The ICRC spoke out extremely strongly. There have been a number of times since, but that speaking out, and I think since, it's been more in defense of international humanitarian law than in a marked commentary on a massive and influential political network and force, which is the European Union. So what prompted it? And how much vetting did you have to do within your ICRC official line to do that? To the extent that you would like to share that, that's one question. The second is, there are two others that are much more operational. I'm very interested in if you can share that with those of us who are here on the methods and strategies you have devised to support medical aid and trauma and surgical care within Syria in the context of your respect for national sovereignty, which means usually getting permission from the nation state, and the Assad regime is the nation state, in your usual insistence on working with at least one or two expat internationally trained Red Cross workers to help supervise or at least co-run operations. And yet in a context now where presumably you have to be training local people to go in and do the bulk of the work. So this is, I'm just interested in the changes and approaches and the adaptations you've had to make in order to be effective in the areas you can reach, which we know are always spotty for everyone in terms of taking care of victims of violence in this war. There's very little, as you said, neutral and nonpartisan space in which to work. The third question, but the second in this more operational line, is have you ramped up your tracing work? I have always respected and been externally grateful for the fact that the ICRC is prominent in tracing separated people in the setting of forced displacement in war. It's a fundamental action of the ICRC. The UNHCR does this to some extent. The coordination, I think, is not 100%. But the ICRC now, with the risks of so many people getting separated and so many people unidentified who are dying or separated, how are these issues of intensification of separation, many children and young people at risk, and many people unidentified, how is this tracing aspect being scaled up, as you would say? And then the third question I have, which is on a larger scale of sort of politics and strategy, as was my first, is given your deep understanding of what prompts this current million to try to get into Europe, and what is going to be prompting another large number of people still from the Mideast, perhaps from Afghanistan and elsewhere, trying to get into Europe, and then what we are seeing and have seen prior to the war in Syria, a growing number of desperate people in this category of what we would call distress migration. They're not simply voluntary economic migrants, as you know well. So distress migration, fleeing poor governance, chronic conflict, and livelihoods collapsed, partly inflected by climate change. The millions that are trying to come from North Africa, the Sahelian states, and probably increasingly from sub-Saharan Africa. So in terms of your anticipation of migration and displaced peoples, what has been, if any, a change in your focus and strategy for Africa? Thank you for the opportunity to hear you speak another time.
Thank you, Jennifer. I think we have a bunch of really great questions. So, Peter, if you could at least try some of them.
Yeah.
Indeed. the choice is difficult. I agree with you that each and every one of the neighboring countries has very distinct realities, has different policies. But there are, again, a couple of things which are interesting and where we would be interesting also to engage with you and with the broader community here at Harvard to find solutions. And you mentioned the educational part. I think it's one of the aspects which we came to the conclusion that we were not equipped at the present moment to respond to the educational crisis caused by the conflicts of the last couple of years. We have always defined humanitarian as being water, sanitation, food, medicine, shelter. Mm-hmm. That's what we are able to do. We have skills and we are able to negotiate access to populations, even in some of the most difficult circumstances, to fulfill the fundamental needs. And education has never been part of the definition of humanitarian response. And so there is no frontline humanitarian actor who is able to deliver and to respond to some of the educational problems which emerge from the generations of displaced, but also for those who are not able to go to school because their schooling infrastructure has been destroyed by the conflict. So here again, the internally displaced versus refugee is an important issue. I have no response to that at the present moment. We are trying to map some of the initiatives which are taken to see whether we can cooperate and see how we can join forces, whether our ability to be at certain places where others have difficulties is opening opportunities. Again, as I said before, ICRC will not become a migration agency and we are not becoming an educational agency, but the question is, can we promote and facilitate the activities of others, and how can we tap into the capacities of others, and what are these capacities, and what are the new technologies that we can use and generate also in order to respond to some of those urgent needs of education, which today, there is no question to me, are integrated part of any reasonable humanitarian response to a crisis. The second remains with what I briefly mentioned is jobs and investments. And here again, it's very interesting. Because the countries are different from one to the other, the practices are different, but there are some important experiences. The Jordanians opened free economic zones to activities for Syrian refugees specifically. So they create specific areas of jobs in order to offer opportunities to the refugees to look after themselves. Letting them onto the labor market causes the tensions that we know each and everywhere. So you can't expect from a country, neither a neighboring country or a European, that they just open the labor market for whoever comes. It's too much for the social cohesion of the respective countries in Europe as well as in other places. So we need different forms and format of controlled openings of labor market timings and sequencings and numbers, and this is part of the politics of each and every one of the country. But I think Turkey and Jordan have been very interested, have followed very interesting models on moving away from camps and offering targeted possibilities to bring people out of the camps. Let's be also very frank on what the politics behind is. When the Syrian crisis began, there was an illusion in the neighboring countries and in many countries beyond that this would be a short moment and a short displacement. They put people into the camps in the opinion that a year later Assad would be away and people would go happily back to Syria. And I agree with you what you said. It's unlikely that this is a scenario, so there are new possibilities in terms of creating jobs and labor markets to look at. I have chaired over the last 2 years a working group in the context of the World Economic Forum on investment in fragile contexts. Very interesting. I think we have underestimated the potential and possibilities of small and medium enterprises to contribute to job creation programs. Of course, if you ask people whether they create a job just for refugees, they won't. The question is what the alternative is and what the deal and the price is. And here again, there are ways to encourage small and medium enterprises, even in some of the most fragile contexts, to create jobs and to look in a different way to their investments as we move forward. So there are very concrete things. There are concrete things that the international community can do. Everybody knows Lebanon is not entitled as a middle-income country to receive special grants from the World Bank. But Lebanon has a specific problems. Millions, 1.5, 2 millions of refugees in the country being a important burden on the economy. So it's obviously a decision which needs to be addressed politically. You can't expect from neighboring countries to foot the bill, to take the refugees, to foot the bill, not to get any assistance from the international community. So there will be political decisions to take in the major financial institutions in order to create supportive environment which encourage the neighboring countries to take the right decisions and to support them into those decisions. As humanitarians also, we have learned to look in a very different way to our programming. We are not doing programming in favor of Syrian refugees in the neighboring countries, because targeting specific programs to Syrian refugees is basically stigmatizing Syrian refugees in the neighboring countries and causing frictions and tensions in the neighboring countries. So what we have started to do is community support for social services in Lebanon. We support hospitals to deliver services to whoever is sick, and not a specific program for Syrian refugees. Because if you do it for Syrian refugees, you'll have the next civil war basically emerging as you do it over time and space. So the design of humanitarian programs in order to address an issue, cope with a problem, and not contribute to further tensions do no harm in the best sense of words in responding on a humanitarian level to the challenges is something which is of quite critical importance. I take your point, Melanie, that or what you say is at the same time a hope I would have that the cost of the present conflicts in the Middle East in particular would somehow entice governments to change their priorities. As long as there is no cost, there is no interest to stop the war in Syria. I think there is an enormous cost or perceived costs of the Syrian crisis now and the front line moving from Syria north. And this leads to a reassessment on where you invest your key political energies. My concern at the present moment is that those decisions which have been taken are not going into that direction. Basically, the decisions coming out of some of the European countries is rerouting humanitarian and development money to care for refugees in Sweden, the Netherlands, and whatever. Mm-hmm. And so this siphons positive contributions to the development of and stabilizations of the regions back to dealing with refugees. It's a zero-sum game, which is of concern to us. In terms of political energy, we see a little bit more hope, because if we wouldn't have had this reaction, we wouldn't see a ceasefire or something like a cessation of hostilities in part of Syria as we see it today. So there is hopefully a reassessment and pondering of where the costs and opportunities are, and as humanitarians, we have said in a long time, and I've been criticized for saying it, as humanitarians, we can't cope with the humanitarian consequence of the Syrian problem. It's too big. We can only start again to be in reasonable dimensions of response if there some of the underlying political causes of the conflict are addressed. And as long as this is not happening, at least to contain some of the most extreme violence, we will not see a fundamental change in the dynamic of the conflict, which is has now been for 4 years the same. Each and every month we do more humanitarian work, and each and every month the situation gets worse. And so if you don't change the mechanics of it, which means to address the underlying drivers of violence in terms of a political settlement of the crisis, and I would add as a humanitarian in terms of respect for international humanitarian law by the parties to the conflict and meaningful pressure on the parties to the conflict to respect, we will not see a change of a dynamic, and the dynamic most likely will lead to more population displacements. In that sense, Jennifer, I'm a little bit cautious to extrapolate and sort of speculate on what exactly population movements are. And what strikes me when I talk on the ground in Syria and in Afghanistan to people, and I ask the question, what makes you move? And where do you who takes the decision to move where? It's a very delicate equation. And the delicate equation is that, I mean, we think it's simple arithmetic, but for the people in Afghanistan and Syria, what surprises me is how rational and calculated they are in pondering 30 factors of positive and negative and reassessing them by the day. And adapting them to the signals and opportunities which come out of the international politics. You can go to the farthest 100 kilometers out of Mazar al-Sharif where I spoke to 15 or 20 elders in a village. They know every word of every European politician who has pronounced itself in the last 12 hours on the migration issue. And they make an assessment whether this means that the chances are bigger or less. And they calculate it to the threats under which they are. They have the Talibans in front of the village, and they have European politicians saying things. And they make an assessment on how this fits, and they take decisions. And it's very unforeseeable how those dynamics unfold. So you can easily imagine that despite all the fears one may have, we may not see an increase of population movement because they, many people may find that the threshold of going to a safe place is too big. They may change alternative places. I was very impressed to see that in Pakistan, in Afghanistan, there is a fascinating sort of mapping of the world on what first, second, third, fourth choices are. When you are poor, your first choice is Iran or Pakistan. And your first choice is not to go to Iran and Pakistan as a legal worker. It's going as an illegal worker to Iran and Pakistan, because in the pondering of the choices, it's better to be exploited as an illegal in Iran or Pakistan than staying in the village where you are. When you have the resources, you know exactly the market price for smugglers from Mazar al-Sharif to Munich. And depending on what your assets are and your possibilities are, you may decide to invest. And the family may decide that one person of the family, that the money is invested in one person of the family to get his way to Europe. When I visited Greece 3 weeks ago, and I was on a boat in the Aegean with the Greek Navy, and I spoke for a day with some of the refugees, they told me that they have prepared for the trip, and the ticket from Aleppo to Munich was basically in the $3,000 to $4,000, and they would make it in 48 hours. So these are refugees and migrants and people who are under threat and pressure. They make very rational decisions on the market. If I look as humanitarian to this, that's not a good deal in terms of protection concerns of people. But it is the result of restrictive policies which basically create a black market with a black market price. And I think it is important that we are aware that migrants do not blindly start to walk. They take informed decisions, and depending on how governments organize the price on the market, the restrictions, the legislative pieces, the opportunities, the alternative routes, the protection concerns that they offer to migrants, depending on the whole mix of everything, the decisions will be taken. The result will be very different in terms of ambitions of humanitarian protection and assistance to those people. They will get a bad deal under certain circumstances, and they will get a better deal under other circumstances. May I just respond to one or two more questions from Jennifer? Why are we outspoken at a certain moment and less outspoken on the other? I have never made outspokenness and confidentiality as a sort of a question of principle. It's a tool to achieve an objective. I think the objective as a humanitarian is to assist and protect people of our concern. If we want to have access to detention facilities in whatever conflict in which we work, confidentiality is normally a good tool to have access. So we may shut up. If we believe that politics in Europe at the present moment are sufficiently open, and these are issues which are discussed in the public space in Europe, there is no functionality of being silent. This is part of the European debate. And so it may be more conducive to address some issues in the public space as everybody else does in the public, pronounce itself in the public space. But I may not make this as a doctrine to treat with the European Union. Of course we are interested in having a diplomatic, quiet conversation with the Europeans on the use of force, on rules of procedures, everything that I mentioned beforehand. And we may not try to have this conversation necessarily each and every day in the public space. But I think it is important as humanitarians to look at the contextual situation and the dynamics of political decision making. And the objective is not to be confidential or outspoken. The objective is to assist and protect people. What is conducive? Sometimes it's outspokenness, and sometimes it's silence. It's a difficult pondering that we are doing each and every day. I know that when I talk too much about my concerns on protection in Europe, I may have some right-wing parties which will express themselves negatively on the ICRC. That's a risk. So we have to ponder risks and opportunities, as migrants do when they take decisions. Humanitarians have to take sophisticated decisions and try to be smart on when we speak in public and when we speak in private and when we look for practical solutions. There is no point in continuously just arguing about violations and about concerns. I don't want to go into history of the debate on migration in Europe as a man who has expressed concerns. Nobody lives from concerns. I need to express concerns in order to start a debate on solutions. That's the functionality of raising concerns. Afterwards, we will have phases of negotiations and debate, and these phases will have to find practical solutions on what the best deal is that we get in the present, at the present moment, on having assurances for the European Union to protect its borders, and at the same time to have people who have legitimate protection needs to come to Europe and to find protection on the European continent. This is what we are looking at the present moment. With regard to medical assistance, I think we, in Syria, I have already with students at Brandeis today, I have spoken about some of the dilemmas in which we are and the characteristics of humanitarian frontline negotiation is that it is a negotiations under big dilemmas. It's not finding the common interest in a complex environment. It's a difficult type of negotiations. We have principles and laws with regard to medical assistance in conflict, and we all know what these principles and laws say. The problem is they are not implementable as such, given the conditions in which we are. So each and every day, we make a difficult choice on what is an acceptable trade-off of assisting medical facilities, mobile medical clinics, supporting medical professions in Syria, and what is an unfeasible compromise, which is compromising the principles under which we operate. And it's a difficult choice. The medical assistance in many conflicts, and in particular in the Syrian conflict, has been the most difficult dilemmas with which we have been confronted. No other sector of humanitarian assistance has been exposed to so much pressure as the medical profession in the Syrian conflict and in many other conflicts nowadays. You can deliver water and sanitation services even in Raqqa. We have done that over the last 2 years. ICRC has fixed water installation in Raqqa, in the heart of Islamic State. It was not, and we haven't done it in any hidden way from the Syrian government. With the permission of the Syrian government and the authorities in Raqqa, we have done this type of humanitarian work. Not possible with medical, because medical in the meantime is seen not as a particularly protected area of activities of humanitarian actors, but as a strategic and as a part of a military strategy. Mm-hmm. And this is what concerns us most in some of the patterns of the conflict in which we are working. We have enlarged the basket of medical assistance in Syria over time because I think we have managed to establish trustful relations with the parties. But the trustful relations are not sufficient at the present moment to have anything which we would like and would define as important medical assistance delivered. But we do more today than we have ever done before. But here again, we are in the sort of strange situation where we do more. We have doubled our medical program in Syria in the last 12 months, but double is too little. Last word with regard to tracing, we have considerably stepped up our work on tracing with in cooperation with the national societies, with the whole Red Cross and Red Crescent movement. If I look at our services today, we have not only scaled up, but we have also modernized our tracing. It's completely digital at the present moment. It has face recognition software, which allows us to match requests from one side to another. We have larger successful rates than ever before in tracing people. We use information systems in order also to get more literate and to use the data that we have from tracing services in order to have a smarter vision on what the protection situation looks like in many of the places. It's some of the critical work that we are doing at the present moment, including on the European continent. We have scaled up and built a tracing service in Eastern Europe. We have tracing officers in Greece as well. And of course, one of the big advantages that I mentioned beforehand is that as a Red Cross and Red Crescent movement, we are in all the countries and we are along migration routes. So tracing services is one of the important issues on which we have scaled, we have modernized, we have considerably enlarged our operations. It's one of the quite successful services. There are three things at the present moment operationally that we do in Europe, except of being concerned on policies and their implementation. It's tracing services, it's visits in migrant detention facilities, and it's dead body management, because we have the largest group of forensic experts helping the Mediterranean countries deal with the dead bodies taken out of the Mediterranean. So that's three operational activities for the time being which ICRC has engaged to, and where we built our operational activities in Italy, in Greece, in the countries of Central and Eastern Europe. But more may come. As Grzegorz said at the beginning, we wouldn't have thought to do that 2 years ago, and we don't know what we will be doing in 2 years' time.
Rumi, do we have time for... Okay, so let me open the floor, please.
Peter, let me thank you very much for this very clear presentation, and the ICRC for the work you've done over the decades, and the panel and the center. And I would agree with your assessment of the Syrian situation and what your canon should do and at this time, et cetera, et cetera. My question is about what your long-term planners and strategic planners and so on and so forth are thinking in regard to what Jennifer Leaning described as stressed migration and the future of stressed migration over the next 30 years. As you know, half the population of North Africa and the Middle East is under 30. These characteristics of mass unemployment and
corrupt and violent governments and the failure of state services and insecurity are universal virtually in Algeria and Egypt and Libya and Yemen and so on and so forth. What does the ICRC see in regard to the broader framework of the issues you've described vis-a-vis Syria and to a lesser extent in Afghanistan, which strike me as being somewhat less, exigent than they may be in some of these other countries along the Mediterranean border. So the question is about the larger framework for the Syrian situation.
Thank you very much. Could you please?
Thank you very much. As a German, I agree with you that the numbers we are talking about are small. Nevertheless, the panic we see, not only in Europe, but in particular there, about these numbers are a little bit difficult then to understand. The political climate has changed in the middle of last year, and it may have to do with the immediate rise of a few more thousands or hundred thousands of people coming. Now, two issues could have stopped things earlier. I mean, even now, more activity around Syria. I mean, in the refugee camps, so far I understand, the situation is very, very poor. International help is not coming, and besides of the panic as such. And the other is, who has not seen and why the huge numbers of people walking from the south of Europe to Germany and more ahead, and has not been able to react earlier. So it's a kind of a mystery what was going on there. So all in all, I agree with you. These are small numbers, and we should react more responsible with the situation. But the question, even then, why are some states, let's say Slovakia and others like that, are so much worried about dozens of more refugees than last year?
Thank you. We have a question in the last row on the right.
So Jennifer raised the issue of climate change, and since it wasn't addressed till now, I'd appreciate if you, I'd like to bring it up again. I mean, do we have any kind of international legal regime that will be adequate to handle the number of refugees from basically unlivable areas of the world, those most impacted by climate change?
Okay, thank you.
Drought in South Africa, rising ocean levels in Bangladesh, for example. There's many, many examples.
Right. Thank you very much. We have one more room in the second row here.
Thank you very much, Dr. Maurer, Jennifer, and our colleague. I would like to ask Dr. Maurer, having talked with people in the region, many people tend to criticize the neighboring countries, Jordan, Lebanon, and Turkey, and as Melanie rightly said, they're in different institutional structures. But the setting in of border controls, of security concerns, which are increasingly making humanitarian action difficult, everyone else is insisting on it, so it seems to me somehow a legitimate concern, and having spoken with a couple of representatives of these countries, there seems to be quite a tendency to believe that sooner than later the prospects for elections in Syria could come, because what I'd rather like us to perhaps see after having raised so many really valuable issues, the best humanitarian action does not replace political decisions and actions. You said it yourself. And there I'd like to come back to Stefanie Mistura's work that the Russians have come on board. The bombarding has become less. Kerry was in Moscow. There seems to be a way open to some sort of cooperation. That perhaps one could think of some compact plan, And of course, the EU-Turkey agreement is on the margin of international law. UNHCR is not part in it. It is only mentioned as a key actor in the resettlement process to provide support and supervision, and it's supposed to be implemented as from yesterday or yesterday before under the supervision of the European Commission Vervé, with 4,000 people, none of them, any of them, one might say, trained in refugee protection and procedures. I think we should see how the implementation comes along, but basically my question is, how do you view looking at the overall picture and solutions that a political process might become possible? I mean, Stephanie Mistura has worked tirelessly to get parties on board. The Islamic front is not part on the negotiation, but how do you see it from your perspective?
Thank you very much. I think we'll go back to here. These are big questions.
Yeah, and a lot of those questions are addressed to the citizen Peter Maurer and not to the humanitarian Peter Maurer, because as a humanitarian, I have little to respond if I want to maintain some neutral, impartial, and independent posture with regard to some of those difficult questions. Huh? As a humanitarian, we don't speculate about the larger population movements in the future. Our main concern is to be prepared to react when it counts fast. So that's a typical humanitarian approach. We don't care too much about the different scenarios. The only thing is that you have to be fast when things go bad. And in that sense, again, as I mentioned in responding to Jennifer, we see different possibilities, and the fact that there are the Russians and the Americans coming to senses and obviously making a calculation that the continuation of all those conflicts without being addressed in common by them together would be a bigger price than just trying to forge some compromise. That's probably what made them sit together, because my interpretation is that the powers in Europe, the United States, the Russians, have seen over the last 12 to 18 months that they were basically losing any control of what was happening in Syria. And I think that's what made them sit together and hammer out a political compromise. And you can only hope that this reasoned approach will pick up, will gain momentum, will lead to a credible political process. But of course, it's a very political question that you ask me. I don't know how this political process will be timed and sequenced and shaped and organized. I can only hope that it will create an atmosphere which will allow us to address some of the stark humanitarian impacts of this conflict, which will continue for quite some time, even if cessation of hostilities should be successful. To my knowledge, there is a lot of talk about climate change and displacements, but there is no sort of legal framework or international framework addressing it in any credible way. We are cautious today when we interpret population movement to pin it down to a legal framework, because it narrows the perspective. I think the whole issue of today's migration movement is that you can't really pinpoint this or that movement as being the consequence of violence, poverty, climate change, or any combination of the three, or some other combinations. I mean, pastoral movements in the Sahel have been a consequence of drought, and the drought is a consequence of climate change. But pastoral movements are not only the consequence of climate change, they are also moving because of tensions in the communities and because of violence in the communities, and they are poor. So alternatives are scarce. So one of the problems that we continue to struggling with in the international community is that we have many reasons which make people move. And we have neatly separated legal instruments to deal with those movements. But the reality is more complex. And therefore, there is this discrepancy between the legal infrastructure to address people on the move and the reality and complexity of motives which makes people move. Legally, you are either a legal migrant or a refugee or an IDP or a Palestinian. That's the four categories on which we have, the international community has offered legal frameworks to put them into a case. But what is the, with regard to the Palestinian who moved from violence in Yarmouk and becomes a refugee in whatever country, you see when you start to play with those categories how artificial those categories are and how much more comprehensive we need an approach in order to understand those dynamics. But here again, my point here at Harvard is, this is the interest of having practitioners and experiences from the field mirrored in sound legal research and policy research and accompanied by methodological input of a great organization like this one. And that's the whole interest of having such a dialogue, not only as we had it in the past, but also continue in the future.
I hope you share my view that this was a very important conversation. And thank you so much to Weizmann family for making that possible. Thank you to Harvard Humanitarian Action Initiative for making that possible. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you, Melanie. And most of all, thank you so much, Peter Maurer.